There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You deserve the glory and the honor. I lift my hands and worship, and I bless your holy name. You deserve the glory and the honor. I lift my hands and worship, and I bless your holy name. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. The glory and the honor. I lift my hands and worship, and I bless your holy name. You deserve the glory and the honor. I lift my hands and I worship, and I bless your holy name. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else.
Good morning, Rockaway. It's indeed a pleasure to be here this morning. It's indeed a blessing that we are here this morning. We have sunshine. We had a storm that passed through last week. But thank God we have a blessed day with sunshine. I'm here on behalf of our Rockaway Church and our pastor to welcome you. And we pray that you will have a blessed and enriched day. Today is BI Day, as you well know, and they will be in charge of the program this morning. So with this prayer, we'll get started. Shall we pray? Loving Father God, we are thankful that you have spared our lives. You have blessed us, Father, so that we can be here this morning. Not just to fellowship, Father, but to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. Father, we pray that this program will be enriched, that we will receive a blessing, and we can share with others as we go. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Lord, you
welcome in this place. Lord, you are welcome in this place. Lord, you are welcome in this place. Have your way.
Morning, everyone. Can you please
Lord, your anointing in this place. Send your anointing in this place. Send your anointing in this place. Have your way. Heal and deliver in this place. Heal and deliver in this place. Heal and deliver in this place. Have your way. Move by your Spirit in this place. Move by your Spirit in this place. Move by your Spirit in this place. Have your way. Send your direction in this place. Send your direction in this place. Send your direction in this place. Have your way. Lord, you are welcome in this place. Lord, you are welcome in this place. Lord, you are welcome in this place. Have your way.
Morning, everyone. Please bow your heads and close your eyes for opening prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful Sabbath you've blessed us with. Please anoint us with this sermon that is about to come from Principal Edwards. Please guide us, keep us safe, help us to understand this word, and help us to learn something new. Please protect us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Can you please stand for the mission statement and motto? Bermuda Institute is committed to encouraging its students to develop a personal relationship with God, challenging them to academic, physical, and social excellence, thus securing them for heaven, service to God, and the fellow men. And our motto, I press towards the mark. Our theme text, he said, if you will listen carefully to the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight, obeying his commands and keeping all his decrees, then I will not make you suffer any of the diseases I sent upon the Egyptians. For I am the Lord who heals you.
Amen.
Thank you. Have a great Sabbath.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to your church, but today your church is being hijacked by Bermuda Institute, your school on campus. We have with us, obviously, some of our students, but also one of our teachers will be speaking for us today. Normally, we would have the choir, we would have the band, we would have a whole list of people, right? But because of the new COVID regulations, church is different, but not just church, school is different as well. But we are still pressing forward towards the mark. And so we are just grateful for Rockaway for the support, and we just want to worship with you today. There are many people who will join us via Zoom, and so I don't know where the camera is. Where's the camera? Back there. So can we wave to all the Bermuda Institute students who cannot be here because of social distance, but they are watching with us right now, some people in their uniform. Hello to all the Bermuda Institute students. And so at this time, we're going to welcome our principal to come give his presidential principal remarks. I think he goes to his church. You guys know this man? Amen. So Mr. Edwards, come and give us your principal remarks.
Good morning, Rockaway. Good morning. And good morning, Bermuda Institute at large. I want to welcome you to Rockaway Seventh-day Adventist Church. And we know that we could not accommodate our choir. We could not accommodate our band because due to the protocols that the Department of Health has in place for us, we don't even have choir classes anymore. We call it general music. We don't have band with wind instruments anymore. And so everything that we do has been changed. We're grateful, though, that Rockaway is able to accommodate us today. And we will have a wonderful program for you. We have a few students who are here who will share with you their love for Jesus. And so be blessed. Thank you very much once again, and may God bless you. Have a happy Sabbath. Thank you.
Thank you.
And by the way, I'd just like to acknowledge our teachers who are here. You met Pastor Keynes. He is our chaplain. He's our Bible teacher. We also have Mr. Swan. Where's Mr. Swan? I saw him. Okay, Mr. Swan is over there. Yes, Mr. Swan is our math teacher. And we have Miss Gordon, who you will hear from later on. We also have one of our newest member of the faculty, Miss June Huggins. All right, welcome. Welcome. This is your church, Rockaway. This is your family, and we thank you. All right. At this time, Pastor will come and give us a word. And then we will hear from Jaden Coleman, our head boy, and some other students. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody, and happy Sabbath to you. We're so glad to have Bermuda Institute family here with us today. Why don't we all say amen? It's good to see each and every one of you. I just want to share just a few things, and then we'll get on with our Bermuda Institute day. First off, I want to say thank you to BI. I know, I believe we were first for this school year in terms of BI days. So in this new season that we're in, social distancing and things of that nature, I want to thank the students, the parents, and the faculty and staff that have come out here today to support. We appreciate you very much. Let me give you some, let's not get so, give you some not so good news, and then we'll end in some good news. Is that all right? So we want to keep the family of Dr. Lightbourne in prayer. Many of us know that Dr. Lightbourne had been battling for many, many years his health, and last night the Lord saw fit to lay him to rest. And so Dr. Ronald Lightbourne passed on last night. We also want to keep the Rettery family in prayer. Neil and Andrea Rettery, members of the Hamilton Church. Neil's father passed this morning. That's why I'm late. I was at the hospital with them, got the call, and in the absence of Pastor Steed, went down there, prayed with the family. And I'm kind of put my morning back just a little bit. And so we want to keep them in prayer as well. I'd also ask that you would keep my own family in prayer. My grandmother lost her sister, my great aunt, Ma Verona, earlier in the week. And we will funeralize her on next week. And so we have quite a bit of deaths. And then there were a slew of deaths and funerals that happened this week, too many for me to recall. And I'm saying that to say that the Inspired Pen lets us know that right before the final age comes into pass, that the Lord will put to rest those who may not make it through the final crisis for whatever reason. And we're looking around, and I want you guys to know that there are just, it just seems, we were in a pastor's meeting just earlier this week, and we were all commenting, it just seems like there's so much death in the land right now. There's so much death in the land. Dr. Manders was commenting or lamenting of how he did 3 to 4 funerals last week and had 3 this week. Pastor Tall had 3 or 4 funerals this week. Also, let's keep the Tall family in prayer, as his wife, Sister Latoya Tall, lost her mother suddenly. And so the Tall family will be traveling, if they haven't already, they will be traveling to Jamaica to funeralize his mother-in-law, Sister Latoya's mother. So we're just seeing all of this death around us. And of course, we have a blessed hope. Amen. We have a blessed hope. And so that's the not so good news, that there are so many people that are struggling with death. And even in, you know, even in this BI day, Faculty and Staff Recruitment Institute, it never, ever, ever is lost on me that Elder Kevin Burgess and Sister Antoinette Burgess are still mourning the loss of a son that should be in 12th grade right now, that should be getting ready to go into the rest of his life. And I got to be honest with y'all that for me, whenever I drive by BI in this season, that's all that I remember first. And I think about Elder Kevin and his wife, and I'll send him voice notes every so often. Just so much, right? It's just so much in the land. And so I want us to continue to keep our brothers and sisters in Christ, those that we know are dealing with grief, and then maybe those that we don't know are dealing with grief, y'all, because there is a lot of grief out there in the land. So that's the not so good news, okay? I want to give you some good news. Is that okay? The good news is I got a call from Zeldin this morning. I want to say amen. Got a call from Zeldin this morning, and they have a video. Some of you may have seen it. I have not seen it, but they have a video of Elder Doug taking some steps. Come on and say amen. Elder Doug taking some steps. And so here we are some 2 or 3 weeks out from the incident, and Elder Doug has taken a few steps. And so we're praising God for the few steps that he has taken. He's able to eat on his own. Zeldin was telling me that he's able to speak with a little bit more clarity, and they're noticing that his mouth movements are a little bit more fluid. So again, we just ought to say amen for that, because if you, again, know the severity of what had happened, to see this turnaround and to see these things come about, all praise be to God for that. They did ask for one very specific thing, and so Rockaway, we are going to pray, and y'all, if you join us as well in this prayer, we are praying for movement in his left arm. Come on now, we are praying for movement in his left arm. That's what they have not seen, any action, according to Zeldin, in the left arm as yet, but they've seen action on the left foot and the left leg. They've seen action on the left side of his face and the left side of his mouth. So the one thing that has not had any action yet is his left arm. And I believe that just as we all talk about the mighty right hand of God, I believe that his left hand got some pop in it too. And so we're going to pray that God will give some of that pop in his left hand to Elder Doug's left hand. And the next update that we'll hear is how he's got complete movement and restored movement in the entirety of the left hand of his body. And y'all, I don't need any unbelievers in the house. I don't need any unbelievers in the house. I need, Elder Eddie, I need people that are going to pray. You know, I'm saying all this, that's going to assault heaven with prayers and prayers claiming victory on behalf of Elder Doug and his family. We're going to pray that thing, man. We are going to pray. We are going to pray healing into that left arm so that when he comes back, he will have full movement of his body. And so we're praising God. Zeldin is home, but he has an aunt, I believe, who lives in Alabama. Some of y'all know they go visit her every so often. And she has taken upon herself to leave Alabama and go up to Boston to be with Sister Queenie and Elder Doug during this time. So she is not alone. Come on. She is not alone. Not only does she have all of heaven on her side, but she has family there as well. And so we are just going to continue to praise God for the progress, for the steps forward that are being made. And we know. Come on, y'all. Come on. We know. We know. The Bible says, and we know. I'm not here to preach, but I wish I just had a witness about something. And we know. And we No. Come on, y'all. And we know that a few things, that some things, that just minor, no. All things work together for what, everybody?
For the Lord.
Of whom?
For them that love the Lord.
And are called according to his purpose. Yo, I believe that the Trop family love the Lord. I believe that they have been called according to his purpose. And so I'm claiming the front half of that promise for them, that all things will work together for their good. And so we're going to claim that in Jesus' name. And so Rockaway and everyone else that's here, I'm asking you if you would join us in this season of prayer, that we assault heaven on behalf of our head elder, Elder Doug, asking very specifically, y'all. Remember, we were being specific about our prayers for him. And so very specifically, what we are asking for is for healing to come in that left hand. And I want you to all know, man, I keep telling you this, every time Zeldin talks to me, the first thing that Zeldin says to me is, Pastor, the prayers are working. I know I keep saying it, but the prayers are working. So y'all, who knows? Who knows what was meant for maybe evil? Who knows? Who knows what was meant for maybe evil? To take him out, to cripple him, to put him on the bed of affliction. God has a way of turning things around and making that thing work out for good. And so if he's done it in the Bible, if he's done it in other situations and circumstances, guess what, y'all? We ought to claim that. I'm done. Listen, I want to thank you all so very much for being here at Rockaway. We appreciate you. Thank you for worshiping with us today. I'm going to invite, who's next? Come on. Jaden Coleman. Yeah, Jaden Coleman, our head boy. We're going to invite him to come up and say a few words at this time. Jaden, if you would come up at this time, our head boy, and he's going to share a few words with us. God bless you guys. Thank you for being with us as we worship God together today in spirit and in truth.
Good morning, everyone. A pleasure to be here. It is BI Day, and we're glad that you guys have us today. So we're going to sing a couple songs, praise and worship. Hope you all enjoy.
Glory, glory,
glory, glory,
hallelujah.
Since I lay
my burdens down, glory,
glory,
hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Since I lay my burdens.
Friends don't treat me.
Friends don't treat me like they used to. Since I lay my burdens down. Friends don't treat me like they used to. Since I laid my burdens down.
Well, I'm singing glory,
glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, 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 hallelujah, hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down.
Burdens down, Lord.
Since I laid my burdens down.
Come on, how many of you believe that we are soldiers? have to fight. Although sadly, we've got to die. But one day, trust me, one day, we won't have to fight anymore. So we should stand up right now. Come on.
Come on, we are soldiers in the army. We have to fight, although we have to die. To hold up the bloodstained banner, we got to hold it up until we die. My father was a soldier, he wouldn't stand on the gospel cloud. Oh, one day he got his word anymore, he could stand up and fight anyhow. Oh, we are soldiers in the army. We have to fight, although we have to die. We have to hold up the bloodstained banner. We have to hold it up until we die.
My mother was a soldier. She had a hand on the gospel cloud. Well, one day God hold, you couldn't fight anymore. Said stand up and fight anyhow. We are soldiers in the army. We have to fight, although we have to die. We have to fold up the bloodstained banner. We have to hold it up until we die.
For our final song, I just think we have to affirm ourselves. We have to trust in the Lord with all our hearts. We have to lean onto him for our own understanding. And in all our ways, we have to acknowledge him, and he will direct our path.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and don't depend on your understanding. All your ways, acknowledge him. He will direct. He will direct. He will direct your path.
One more time, trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord.
With all your heart.
Thank you, thank you.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everyone. Okay, we have reached prayer time. We're about to call on our Father above. Anyone with any requests, just raise your hand. And as we heard, we do have a praise. We have one praise at least for Brother Doug. The Lord is working in his body.
Sitting at his feet, sitting at his feet, there is where my life is complete, sitting at his feet, sitting at his feet.
sitting at his feet. There is where my life is complete, sitting at his feet.
Lord, prepare
me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this privilege that we have to come into your presence through prayer. We thank you for being such a loving and faithful God. We thank you for all the blessings that you just continue to bestow upon us day by day. We thank you so much for what you have done in Brother Doug's life. In his health. Father, he's come a long way, but you're not finished with him yet. And right now, Father, we have been asked to pray specifically for his left arm. We need to see some movement in his left arm. He needs to feel his left arm move. And Father, we ask that you would just go closer to him right now, touch his body, and heal him all the way. Maybe we hear the news next time that his left arm has moved. We thank you. We thank you for how you're working in all our lives, Father. We thank you especially for our school, your school, Bermuda Institute. We thank you for the students that are here today, the teachers, the staff, the principal, and all those who are watching on and those who will be participating as we go along. We thank you for our school, Father, and we ask that you would put a special blessing upon our principal, our staff, our teachers, our students, and their families. Father, we know that the evil one would like to knock us all down, but we claim your power, and we ask that you would not leave us. Just stay with us all the way. Continue to bless and guide that Bermuda Institute can be a light in this world of darkness. Father, we have so much to be thankful for, and yet we have so many needs also. We ask for your power, your healing power. You know all the needs that we have, and we ask that you would just come close to us now, that you would send your spirit to touch whomever and whoever, wherever. We ask for complete healing in Jesus' name. And Father, there's a waiting congregation now. They need to hear a word from you. And we know that you have a word for us. We ask your blessing upon the speaker, and we ask that we will be receptive and receive the word that you have for us today. Continue to guide and direct in all our lives. Be with our pastor and his family, all families represented here today. We thank you so much for all you've done and all you're going to do. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Sitting at his feet. Sitting at his feet.
God is where my life is complete, sitting at his feet, sitting at his feet, sitting at his feet. There is where my life is complete, sitting at his
Good morning again, everyone. You know, when you look out in the audience, sometimes you can't recognize even your own because you guys are all masked up. And I was waiting for this moment to introduce our parents, but I only see one parent, Sister Edwina. Could you just say hi? Are there any other parents from Bermuda Institute? All right, we see grandparents, yes. Thank you for joining us live. Thank you very much. I want to introduce our head boy and head girl. We met Jaden Coleman, who led out with our praise and worship. Jaden Coleman, okay. And then we have our head girl, Angel Seaman. And then we have here with us also from the yearbook team, Gail Bean. All right, amen. And so you'll see her taking pictures as you go. Now, one of our teachers that I miss because she was all masked up is Miss Kirk, Miss Dawn Kirk. She's sitting over there. Thank you for joining us, Miss Kirk. is a new teacher for this year, but she has worked with Bermuda Institute for years before. And so we have brought her back into the fold. And so we thank you for joining us, Ms. Kirk. Our speaker for today is one of your church members. Yes, a female. Yes, and so Miss Millicent Gordon. This is her second year at Bermuda Institute. She will be delivering the word today. Miss Gordon is originally from Jamaica. She has worked in various capacity and in various countries. She's worked in Jamaica, she's worked in England, she's worked in Grand Cayman, and that's where she came from. And I know her friends from Cayman are joining her to make sure they see everything that she does. Her sister is joining, her sisters probably, joining her also, joining us online. And so we welcome you. Happy Sabbath. Mrs. Gordon, even though you see her, she's quiet, and but not, you can't take her lightly, okay? She has had some deaths in her family, and because of COVID, she has not even gotten a chance to mourn them. When she came here, she had just buried her sister. And so just keep praying for her. And pray that the Lord will be with her today as she presents his word. She is a child of God, and we present her to you. She has something to say, and I know God has been blessing her. However, before she comes, you will hear from our lovely Dakota Tucker. As she comes live, this young lady has won awards. She has been singing for us. Oh, she sings great. And her grandmother has brought her here for us to hear her live. And so please, let's welcome her. Let's give her a round of amen as she comes forth and praise God. Thank you, Dakota, for joining.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Today I will be singing Because of Who You Are. I hope you enjoy.
Because of who you are, Jehovah Jireh, my provider, Jehovah Nisi, Lord, you reign in victory. Jehovah Shalom, my Prince of Peace. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Because of who you are, I will lift my voice and sing. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Jehovah Jireh, my provider. Jehovah Nisi, Lord, you reign in victory. Jehovah Shalom, my Prince of Peace. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Jehovah Jireh, my provider. Jehovah Nisi, Lord, you reign in victory. Jehovah Shalom, my Prince of Peace. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. You are, you are, you are. Lord, I worship you because of who you are.
Good morning, Rockaway, my family. Let me just say hello this morning to my family in Jamaica. And I do get teared up when I think about them. I know my sister is probably on her way to church. She's supposed to be Sabbath school superintendent this morning, so it's quite likely that while Wayne's driving, she's watching on her phone, and my niece Ruth Ann, and my other sister Carol. I want to say I love you all, and I will be home soon. I know my cousin in Texas is watching as well, and my other cousin in Oklahoma, Pastor Kevin Bruce, before he goes to preach, he'll be watching as well. And then my other adopted family in the Cayman Islands, Tracy and Joydell, I love you. Okay, I'm a little bit emotional because Mr. Edwards touched a chord about my family that I've lost. So I'm going to take a deep breath and hope that I can do this without crying. Okay. All right. Now, I had a story for the children because One of my concerns is that so often we forget the children. And so I had a story, but this morning my memory key was just acting up, so I was not able to. You have it? Okay, great. So if you could, Brother Jack. Now, children are my favorite people. And one of the things I enjoyed when I was in the Cayman Islands was teaching the little ones. Because I'm also a professional librarian, so I worked as a librarian there as well. And so it was a joy for the children to come to the library, and they loved it. And so I just want to share the story. And I like to use the graphics because a picture is worth a thousand words, and the little children enjoy it more when they see pictures. Oh, there we go. So that's my story box that you're seeing right there. And in my story box this morning is a true story, actually. One that I was told when I was a little girl, and that was many, many years ago. It's a story about a little girl called Amy. Now, Amy was 6 plus 1. And my grade 2 students who are watching could probably tell me how old she was. And I'm sure I can hear them saying 7. She was 7 years old. Now, Amy had a family member that she loved dearly. He was her favorite person in the whole world. He was her grandpa. Now, grandpa had something that fascinated Amy. He had a wristwatch. Now, like I said, this is a story from way back when. And oh dear, I missed my cue because I wanted them to sort of unscramble that word. But there it is. He had a wristwatch. And Amy just loved to hear the wristwatch go tick, 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 tick every time Grandpa came and he put her in his lap. She just loved it. And she wanted a wristwatch just like Grandpa's. But he said, when you get older. Now, Amy had a birthday coming up, and she was going to be how old, Jalen? How old would she be? She was 7, and she was having a birthday. Sorry for picking on you, Jalen. 8. She was going to be 8 years old. Yes. And she was excited. And she went to school, and when she got back home, Dad said, I've got a special present for you. It's from Grandpa. And, oh, she was so excited. And he gave her the box, and she immediately started to, she shook it first, like all excited little girls would, because she wanted to figure out what was in it. And Dad said, oh, go on, open it up. And she opened up the box, and inside the box was her own special present. That's that word unscrambled. And it was her own wristwatch. Now, I told you it's an old story. So back then, wristwatches didn't have batteries like mine or cells. They had springs, and they had to be wound every so often for them to work. So she was very excited, and she quickly placed the wristwatch on her hand, and she was just about to run out of the house to go show it to her friend Anne, who lived next door, when Dad said, hold a second. Before you do that, we've got to make sure the correct time is set and that it is wound. So Dad took the wristwatch, and he set the correct time, and he wound it. And she put it back on, and she was about to go again. And he said, hold on, there's one more thing. The people who make the watch usually place the instructions in the watch for how to take care of it. So we've got to read the instructions. Oh, can we do that later?
she asks, he says, oh no, we've got to make sure that you take care of this present, so I want us to read the instructions. And so Dad opened up the manual, and he read the instructions for Amy. And there were two things in particular that he underscored. He said, the manual says that you shouldn't go in the bathtub with this watch, and it should be wound every 2 days. And she said, okay, I get it. And she went off to show her friend the watch. And for 2 weeks, she wore it every day, everywhere, except in the bathtub. But one day, she forgot that she was wearing the wristwatch, and she got in the bathtub, and she was almost halfway through her bath when she remembered that she was wearing the watch. She jumped out, and she quickly dried it off, and she looked at the face, and it looked a little foggy, but she says, you know, it will probably go away. But it didn't. Next morning, it was still foggy, and it wasn't ticking, and Amy was devastated. She tried to hide it from her dad, but sooner or later he realized she wasn't wearing the watch. And when he asked, she was about to lie, but then Dad had told her never to lie. So she told him what happened. And he said, how long ago was that? And she said, oh, it was about 2 weeks ago. And he shook his head. He said, if you had come to me at that time, I probably could have helped you. But right now, it's probably all rusty inside, and you have just ruined your present. Now, boys and girls, God, our Maker, made Adam and Eve and placed them in the Garden of Eden, and he gave them some instructions, but they didn't obey, and as a result, sin came into the world. Our lesson for today, boys and girls, is that we should always obey our Maker. He has designed rules to protect us, and if we follow those rules, our lives will be perfect. Now, I hope you enjoy the rest of the service, and if you're watching BI students in grades 6 down to grade 1, I want you to listen. And every time you hear me say the word education, I want you to write it down. Because if you can tell me on Monday how many times I said the word education, I'll have a gift for you. Sorry, big ones. All right. Now, I've entitled my talk this morning, see, I'm not a preacher, and I'm not the daughter of a preacher, so I will not be preaching. I just want to put that out, okay? But I'll be talking to you. Our text that I want us to contemplate for today is 1 Peter 2 and verse 9, and in the tradition of Pastor Hendrickson, I'd like for you to stand as I read it. I don't have it on the screen. As a matter of fact, there are two texts I want us to contemplate. 1 Peter 2 and verse 9 and Isaiah 54 and verse 3. And the first one says, and I'm sure we all know it, those of us who have been in the church for a long time, it says, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, that you may proclaim the excellence of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. The next one, Isaiah 54 and verse 3 says, and all your children shall be taught of the Lord, and great shall be the peace of your children. You may sit. Now, one of my favorite things to do on Sundays, as I grew up in Jamaica in the early 70s, was to read the comic strips on a Sunday morning. My dad would buy the newspaper, and I couldn't wait for him to get back in, and I would grab the paper, shake out the comic strip, which was nice and colorful, and I would sit down and read. Now, one of them that I found particularly humorous was Bringing Up Father. Bringing Up Father was the story of an Irish-American called Jiggs, a former bricklayer, and his wife Maggie, an ex-laundress, who achieved sudden wealth and all the trappings associated with it. Now, while Jiggs continued to socialize with his old neighborhood friends down at Dinty Moore's Tavern, the snubbish, social-climbing Maggie and their beautiful daughter, Nora, constantly tried to elevate him against his will to his new social position. Maggie was so determined to retrain her husband's mind that she would sometimes hit him over the head with a rolling pin. Now, don't try that at home. I have entitled my talk, Bringing Up Royals, which is a spin-off of Bringing Up Fathers. However, Bringing Up Royals is not about social climbing. Rather, it's about preparing our children for ascent, ascent to the kingdom of heaven. I believe that the importance of what I have to say requires the passion and intentionality of Maggie, minus the rolling pin, of course. It's about the church fulfilling its divine mandate to consciously train its youth to relinquish their innate carnal nature and to embrace a spiritual mindset. It is about the church being intentional in training its children to recognize their royal heritage, that they will take their rightful places as useful citizens in this present life while preparing for the life to come. Let us pray. Lord, I believe that what I'm about to say is what you want me to say. So speak in accents clear and still, above the murmur of self-will. Oh, speak and help us to listen, dear Savior of our souls. One would have to be living under a very large rock to not notice that there seems to be a growing conflict between what is preached in the church and what is observed in the daily life of church members today. The enemy seems to have succeeded in making most of us have a form of godliness while denying the power thereof, as 2 Peter 3, 1-5 has said. The decline of spirituality and lack of commitment to Christ and his church makes one wonder whether there will be anyone to carry on the work after the old guard has passed. It is for this reason that the cry of the spirit of prophecy for an army of youth rightly trained is probably needing to be more insistent now than in the past. For if our children could have their characters formed through the true Adventist Christian education, the gospel would spread more rapidly, the latter rain would be poured out sooner, and the Lord's coming would be hastened. I am sure that most of us are familiar with this often quoted paragraph by Ellen G. White. With such an army of workers as our youth rightly trained might furnish, how soon the message of a crucified, risen, and soon coming Savior might be carried to the whole world. How soon might the end come, the end of suffering and sorrow and sin? How soon, in place of position here, with its blight of sin and pain, our children might receive their inheritance, where the righteous shall inherit the land and dwell therein forever. where the inhabitants shall not say, I am sick, and the voice of weeping shall be heard no more. But despite the successful schemes of the devil to cause us to neglect our sacred responsibilities in the past, it is not too late for the church to reverse the situation. The church can rise up and train its own children the way they should go. The church can decide to make sacrifices for its present and future, an army of youth that will neither be bought nor sold. Children and young people who will represent their Savior, both in words and actions, and who will not compromise the divine standards, no matter the cost. This is the time, more than ever, for the church to invest heavily in her children's education. If she will survive the impending tempest spewed out of the mouth of the dragon and the host of his allies, she must now bring forth and bring up children of her kind, children who truly have the patience of the saints, who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus. The enemy of the church cannot be vanquished with worldly weapons, so she will need children who will not renounce their faith in times of trial, children who will not betray her mission and identity. What she needs are children who would rather blow the trumpet in the midst of tribulation to announce the soon arrival of the King of Kings. Pardon me. The time has come for the church to look back, examine, and see the many generations of her children that have not benefited from Adventist Christian education, and begin to measure the effects of such deficiency and resolve to offer to younger generations better opportunities of knowing the Lord in words and actions. Denying a child of true Adventist Christian education is no less sinful than equating that child with animals and plants that were made to live by instinct and can therefore render no account to their maker. True education, first of all, requires the unlocking of the brain paths of thinking and reasoning. And Ellen White says that our children should become thinkers and not mere reflectors of other men's thoughts. The Lord himself has wired our brain in such a way that we can connect with him through the written word as well as the book of nature. And Adventist Christian education teaches our children how to read and observe, how to discern and appropriately interpret the signs of the time. This is what makes true Adventist Christian education both imperative and indispensable for success in this present world and in the world to come. And the spirit of prophecy emphasizes this fact as it declares that in the highest sense, the work of education and the work of redemption are one. For in education, as in redemption, other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Nothing should be allowed to be an impediment to Adventist Christian education. It is sinful to think and believe that it is not possible to provide Adventist Christian education to all children. Since we profess that nothing is impossible to our God, we must consequently and practically believe that it is possible for all our children to receive true education in Adventist schools. After all, don't we say, and rightly so, that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us? We must understand clearly that sending our children to school is not always synonymous with providing them with education, because not all schools provide education. While it can be assumed that all schools provide literacy and numeracy, these two, without the purpose of being tools or paths to knowing God, would result at best in learnedness, not in education. This is why Adventist families and churches cannot be satisfied with having their children merely going to any school. Public and some private, including faith-based schools, strive only to provide learnedness. Hardly do they care about integrating faith and learning, faith and teaching, or faith and living. Their major concern is to train children and youth to become successful in this transient world, regardless of what their destiny would eventually be. The Seventh-day Adventist Church, being the remnant church, has been called to prepare the end-time generations of the world for the soon return of the Lord. Her work primarily revolves around training the children the way they should go, the way that will let them come to Christ when they grow up, so they will not forsake the way, but rather prophesy and have visions, even becoming wiser than their teachers. And I'm going to repeat that, even becoming wiser than their teachers. Yes, those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not go weary. They will walk and not faint. Let the children come to me, says Jesus. Let us not send his children to be trained in Babylon or worldly schools with the hope that when they grow up, they will come back the way they should go. Let us not expose their character formation to the corrupting and corroding philosophies of this world, because it will be difficult to bring them back when they're old, if they come back at all. The church today is suffering from many unconverted men and women at all levels of church life, because they grew up feeding on a mixture of divine and worldly standards. This unfortunate trend has resulted over the years from Adventist children attending non-Adventist schools, where they're taught, among other things, that God does not exist, that man evolved from lower animals, and that life has been on earth for millions of years. Then on Friday night and Sabbath morning, they're taught the opposite. With such an ambivalent or confused mind, our children are growing to become the main enemies of the church, because we fail to offer them what would make them true members of the remnant church. Moreover, the church must remember that children generally believe their teachers more than their parents and pastors, because it is believed that the teachers pave their path to earthly success, which is the sole purpose of worldly learnedness. So if they're taught by teachers who know God, then you know what is more than likely to happen. Our children are becoming what their schools tell them more than what the church thinks it is instilling in them. Let us therefore no longer sacrifice God's children's education on the altar of lack of money, while a lot of expenses are regularly made on things that have no eternal value. Let us remember that God is not so homeless that we should hide behind the excuse of building him a church to the detriment of providing schools for his children. God is not allergic to children, that we cannot use church buildings as classrooms to educate his little ones. God does not value sparsely used, magnificent church buildings more than simple buildings where his little children could be prepared every day for a meaning life here and the hereafter. Let us therefore not send his children to the world for training, because the world would, at best, offer them learnedness, not education. The world itself, with its institutions, is suffering from lack of true education. Its emphasis on mere learnedness has resulted in producing clever devils, as the Duke of Wellington rightly said, rather than moral intellectuals. The holistic decline of discipline, morality, love, peace, basic human kindness, respect for elders, and even genuine prosperity is a direct result of preferring learnedness over education. That is why Jesus insists that the children should be allowed to come to him while they're still little. And Adventist Christian education is the path for children to the Lord. Let us therefore endeavor to bring our children up as royals, children of the heavenly King. For if our children are taught of the Lord, great indeed shall be the peace of our children. Now, at this time, I'm going to invite Pastor Keynes to come up, and I'm going to ask that you pray, Pastor Keynes, for the Spirit of the Lord to settle in the minds of the hearers, both in the physical space and in cyberspace, what I think he has laid on my heart, and that our churches will, in greater measure, rally to the support of Bermuda Institute so that the work of the Lord can continue there and the training of young people who will take up the guard after we have passed will be guaranteed.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, and we are so grateful for how you poured out your spirit this morning. I felt like we were listening to a prophet of old speak to your people. Remind us of the mandate that we have, not just as Christians, but the special message that you have given to us as Seventh-day Adventists. The uniqueness that we don't just have a church, Lord, but we build schools to educate, liberate, and prepare our young people, not just for this world, but for the world to come. Thank you, Lord, for Ms. Gordon and the message that you gave, Lord. But Father, you heard her request. And so we are praying for the hearts of the people that are listening to this message in the church, and also those who are watching online, and if it's being recorded, those who will watch a rebroadcast. Lord, we are praying that their hearts will literally get no rest if they are not properly supporting your school on this island. We are not just put here to give education and equip them for a good job, for a big house, because these hurricanes are reminding us that these houses will get swept away and get damaged. But Lord, we are praying, Lord, for the people who can financially support students who want to come to Bermuda Institute, Lord, that their hearts will be moved. For people who are able to come and just contribute an hour or two, Lord, and just read to the children, Lord, or just share their testimony during chapel time, or just pray for the principal and for the teachers, Lord. We are asking you, Lord, for the hearts of man to be moved, Lord. Father, I am praying for those students that we currently have that they continue to experience you in a new way, that they are lit on fire for you and with the message of the everlasting gospel, Lord, the three angels' message, Lord, to send into the whole wide world and let them know that we are not just living for this world, but for the world to come, Lord. We pray that you continue to strengthen Ms. Gordon, continue to be with her family, continue to be with everyone underneath the sound of our voice, Lord. But Father, we are claiming that Bermuda Institute becomes filled not just with students just because they want to attend a different school that's an alternative from public school, Lord, but they want to receive the blessings of God, that they see there's something different about Bermuda Institute, that people are living different. People are not being hypocrites, Lord. People have a passion that they are living for, a purpose that they have once they leave your school, Bermuda Institute. Thank you for the service. Thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to hear from you. Father, allow us to meditate on this word, but not just that, share that with somebody else. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. 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 She said that was a talk, but that was a powerful word of God. Amen. And as our principal was saying, we are still taking applications at this time. If you have a grandchild, I'm not joking, a child, somebody that you know, because again, as Ms. Gordon said in the sermon, we are not just preparing educated individuals, because we know that people can die at any age. And so we are preparing them not just for this world, but for the world to come. And so we are going to ask our head girl to come to give closing prayer, and then I believe Alder would have something to say after that. All right, so this is my mask on COVID as she comes to pray.
Happy Sabbath, church. We're going to bow our heads and close our eyes for closing prayer. Dear Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for allowing us to come and listen to a wonderful word given by Miss Gordon. Thank you for her and her ministry at school and at church, God. Bless her, and thank you for the example that she is to us. At this time, I ask that you take us to our different destinations safely, be with those people on Zoom as well, God. And thank you for Christian education, and help us to work to allow Christian education to be prosperous in these coming years. Be with the youth and the students at BI, the teachers at BI, administration, and all of us, God, the church. Forgive us of all our many sins, and Jesus' name I pray, amen.
I'm sure you were blessed and informed. To any of our members or friends who have been contributing to Bermuda Institute, this is just a sample of what your contribution is going to. Christian education is necessary. You train the mind, and that is your contribution to the world, these children that are coming up. You can see in our world that there are so many untrained minds, what they do and where they end up. We're trying to train them so they can get to the kingdom. Sister Millicent, we want to thank you for that sermon. Now we know who we can call on. That was beautiful. We're going to transition into our other mode of continuing Rockaway's way. We have some cards here, as is our tradition, to acknowledge birthdays and anniversaries of our members. First one here, Sister Cheryl Kerr celebrated a birthday on the 1st of October. We know Sister Cheryl is watching. So we want to say happy birthday, Sister Cheryl. We have a card for you, and we'd like for you to come and get it. Next, we have Sister Erin Basden. Am I messing up your name? 27th on the 27th, she celebrated her birthday. That's fine. We are heading in that direction. Happy birthday, sis. We're covering the month of September. We have Brother Rejoy Gibbons. Rejay. I'm not the best person for names. 29th of September, we want to wish you a happy birthday and thank God for you. Sometimes I even mess up my name. Elder Henry and Sister Terilyn Gibbons, I believe this is an anniversary. Happy anniversary, Elder. I didn't say how many years, though. Are you going to share that with us? Happy birthday, my Elder. Bless you. May God continue to bless you. 2035. Wow. Wow. That sounds a mighty long time, doesn't it? Blessings. And, Elder Henry Gibbons. Was this by design, to get married around your birthday? Bless you. Happy birthday. And it is our custom to ask Brother Danny to play the jingle, the birthday song, and the happy anniversary song. Doc?
Happy birthday, your friends are all singing. May the day of his coming bring gladness to you. May he teach you to be faithful, kind-hearted and loving. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you. Happy anniversary, happy anniversary. Now friends are all singing. May the day of his coming bring gladness to you. May he teach you to be faithful, kind-hearted and loving. Happy anniversary, happy anniversary. Happy anniversary to you.
Amen. I almost forgot that, but we had a student from BI, Brother Jalon. Yes. The last time I saw him, I was looking down at him. Now I'm actually looking at him right across. It's the food at Bermuda Institute, isn't it? Well, praise God for you. It's good to see you standing here at the podium leading out. That is a blessing indeed. Makes me feel older. Okay, we will move into our tithe and offering. Did the deacons come forward?
With a grateful heart, give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ his Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ his Son. And now let the weak say I am strong. Let the poor say I am rich. Because of what the Lord has done for us, and now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks, give thanks, give thanks,
give thanks, give thanks, give thanks, give thanks.
Bringing all the tithe in the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house. And prove me now herewith, if I will not open to you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that you shall not have room enough to receive it. Loving Father God, indeed we are thankful that you have blessed us so much, Father, that we can return to you a faithful tithe and offering. Father, we pray that you'll bless it. We also ask, Father, that you'll bless those who were not able to give. You know their hearts. You know their condition, their situation. So, Father, we ask that this will be used in the furtherance of your ministry. Through Jesus' name, amen.
Lord, shall we be seated? Lord, we need your love. Lord, we need your love. Shower with your love.
We will now move into our Sabbath school lesson after our 5 minutes break. Is there a class for the kids today? Yes, the kids will go upstairs. We'll get outside, stretch a little, breathe some of that fresh air, get some of that good sun, vitamin D, and we'll come right back here in 5 minutes to review the lesson. And I believe Sister Debbie will be leading out. That's correct. Amen. All right. So 5 minutes, we'll be back right here.
As children of God, it requires faith and trust, belief in the word of God. And she was making the emphasis in education as opposed to learnedness. But we are all in every aspect of our lives being prepared for the home to come, for the promise of God and for our redemption. the work that Christ is doing, and so it is fitting that as we go through to this week's study, we think about in a very personal way, in our own lives, how is this step of faith, how does it apply to us, what has happened in the lives of others, and we thank you for your participation today. Our memory text comes from Philippians 2, 5, and 7. If someone could just read that for us, huh?
Lesson 13,
September 19-25. Could I get a reader for Philippians 2, 5 to 7?
Reading from the New King James Version. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men.
And I'm going to also read that in the NIV. This is the NIV for the same verses. It says, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ, who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. Our lesson starts where it says that Jesus came to this world of suffering and death in order to reveal the Father's character of love, to win back the affection of the human race and to redeem all humankind. Never can the cost of our redemption be realized until the redeemed shall stand with the Redeemer before the throne of God, from Desire of Ages, page 131. So we see that in order for a part of the preparation, it said that the mind of Christ, that we must have that same mindset as our Savior, which asks us to consider what do we think that, what do we understand as the mind of Christ? Let this mindset be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. What does that mean to you? Well, it tells us that there was, oh, go ahead, Donovan.
Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus, is replicating Christ, is what his teachings were to us. We should be doing the same.
Yes. And in order for us to be like Christ, we have to allow the Holy Spirit to do that work of transformation in us. But it also directs us to show that Christ had a certain manner in which our thoughts are just as important, and we must try to emulate what he thought. In Sunday's lesson, as we just move on a little, it talks about this Jesus self-sacrificing love. And as we seek to become like him, we can look at what the lesson speaks about in how Jesus thought, his thinking and the pattern that governed his entire life. It says, from all eternity, Jesus was equal with God, who was in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with him. It says that Jesus voluntarily emptied himself of his privileges and his prerogatives as God's equal to take on the form of a man and become a humble servant of humanity. As a servant, he revealed heaven's law of love to the entire universe and eventuality. He performed the ultimate act of love on the cross. He gave his life to save ours eternally. The essence of Jesus' thinking was self-sacrificial love. Now, in our relationships and ongoing transformation, this we must always keep in mind that there is a pattern that should govern even our thoughts. Brother Wayne?
Yes. The mind of Christ is always to save others. And later on in the lesson, we will see the sacrifices that Christ made and that we have to make. It when in the section that you read on the Sabbath, if you could read further, it talks about when we get to heaven, what we see and what Christ left heaven for us, just to come to save us. You know, and we now need to sacrifice to save others so that they can gain that glory. Satan knows what he left up there, and he doesn't want us to get there. And so this mind of Christ is to save others, to save the lost. And we too, whatever sacrifices we have to make for him, it's incomparable to what we will receive.
Yes. Brother Stewart?
As Christ was in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he had the sins of the world on him, but he said, not my will, thy will be done.
Yes.
Because he could have, going back to heaven, said, no, Lord, not my will,
yes, thy will. And that self-sacrificing love, the sacrifice that Christ made from coming from the glory of heaven, for us, we have no idea what he left to come to us. The little that our human imaginations can expand to try to imagine what heaven is like cannot compare. And the Bible does tell us that we will not even be able to think. It's above our human mind what is even waiting for us when we go. But to think of the best that in our human state that we can imagine that it was what heaven was like for Christ in perfection, in happiness, in holiness, in order to come to this earth, that we ourselves, no matter how long your days, you could live to, 120, 130, I think may have been the oldest human being, and you will still be burdened with the effects of sin. But to come from perfection into, which would almost be, for want of a better phrase, a sewer of society, to see all of the disruption. For many of us who travel, you may go and leave your home, you may leave Bermuda, you may go to different parts of the world, and even with the little that we have, not being millionaires, but being people who are live perhaps at a certain standard that we become accustomed, if you go to another part of the world, or even in parts of the first world where you would expect to see maybe a certain standard in a hotel or a resort or Gulf of Bid or cruise ship, but we notice the difference in standards. And sometimes we in our humanness are appalled to think that we can't even enjoy the same standard that we're used to. But imagine Christ, which just far exceeds what our human experience is, but he came from perfection into this world with this sole focus of being able to save, to redeem, and to have us enjoy what he knows was the always planned for us. So self-sacrifice, in each one of our experiences as a follower of Christ, he is setting the example that we should be aware that salvation requires not just a step of faith, but sacrifice. So as we think of that, even in our own individual circumstances, comparing what Christ left for us and how he sacrificed, as we consider what are we doing, what are we willing to sacrifice as we compare our lives with the life of Christ. Wayne?
Yes. What Christ sacrificed, as Sabbath lesson said, is incalculable. However, God, Christ is God, equal with the Father. And we have to understand that Christ
took on the form of man to become no longer omnipresent, but he gave that up so that he could save us to be in everywhere at all times. He gave that up. You know, he could have failed. It wasn't like it's and Satan knew that it was possible that he could have failed, and he took that risk. That's how much he loves us and wanted to save us.
Yes. And when you think of the possibility of failure, the possibility that he could have failed, the love that motivated him to come seems ever more significant. We tend, many of us, to assume that it was not as much of a big deal as if Christ, being God and man, could not have failed. But that element of uncertainty heightens and should hammer home the love that motivated him. Sister Terry?
And it just made me think of, because of that great love, he was almost, even though he could have failed, I think he knew all along that he would not fail because of the fact that he loved us so much. You know, he came to this earth. It may have seemed like a mission impossible, but with Christ, all things are possible. He said, "Not my will, Father, but thy will be done." And it was God's will that he would go on the cross and die for our sins. So in his submission to God, he knew that he was not going to fail. You know, because he submitted to God, and with God, like I said, all things are possible. It was their plan, and nothing fails with our Heavenly Father. So even though he as a human probably felt the impossibility of it, because of his faith and his trust in God, he knew, and because of his great love for us, there was no way that he was. That's how I see it. You know, it might simply be an extension to what it's been already said, but I just think of, because of his great love, he said, "I'm going to go to the cross no matter what, you know, for these people." So I'm appreciative of that.
That speaks also to the commitment that he has, and yet the word does tell us that Christ was a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. This was no easy thing, but he had committed himself to the salvation, the redemption of his creations back to where he had, where the God had expected us to be all along. Henry?
Yeah, I'd just like to focus on the extent of his love for us, that he would choose to not necessarily gamble, but to take a chance, because he exiled himself from the very home that he is used to, the very lifestyle he's used to, the power he's used to, the privileges he's used to. He gave all that up just to save if it was just one of us. So that's great love. That's love that I can't comprehend, because I can't tell you how things were in heaven except for what the Bible says. Christ, God, his word says, no man has seen or has even come to the hearts of man, the things that God has prepared for us. So you can only imagine what kind of glory that surrounds the throne of heaven. And Jesus was in the presence of God, and he gave all that up. He turned, almost like he's turning his back on it, but he wasn't turning his back. He was giving off himself. And I just can't explain that kind of love.
Yes.
And just to think about it, it shall cause us to think deep within ourselves. What are we doing in return to that great love? What are we doing?
And yes, that love makes us, begs the question, who do we love like that? Yeah. Do you love anybody like that? Do you believe you have? Now, that is a love that comes just from Christ, because that is a love that is far beyond any kind of Hallmark card. That is love that stays in the trenches. That is love that just pursues and continues. That is love that says, not my life, but your life is more important. But it begs every believer, Who do you love like that? If you don't love like that, then you must go to the giver of love to get that love like that, because we cannot compare ourselves with Christ until that love is in us, that comes from him. That will motivate us, not just a step of faith. It's, the lesson is speaking about a step of faith in terms of soul winning, to help to redeem. Brother Joe?
Yes. I think the emphasis even in Sunday's lesson was about love. It says Jesus meant that we should love as he loved, serve as he served. And do we really love the way Jesus loved? Do we serve mankind the way he did? We need to be serious about this thing, love. God came to show us how to love, and we need to emulate that self-sacrifice. Love. Now, could you imagine someone done you wrong? But Jesus says, no, I want you to love that person, regardless what they have done. I want you to show love to yes. mankind. That sucks. And to serve mankind the way I do.
Yes.
Now, are we really taking that part of self-sacrifice seriously about the love? When anyone comes in the presence of any of us, they should find that love that Jesus has.
Yes.
Sure. Does anyone find that type of love in you
yes.
when they meet you?
Yeah.
It does.
That is a different love. Yes.
So this is the love that we need to be shown to the world so that we can be filled with God's Holy Spirit. God can't give us the Holy Spirit in his fullness until we learn how to love the way he did.
Yes.
And to serve mankind the way he did.
Yes.
I think we should be spending more time trying to emulate Jesus' method of love and service so that his Holy Spirit can take us from one point to another.
Okay. Yes, thank you, Brother Joe. Brother Stewart?
In my Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9, it says, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And the lesson asks at the bottom of Sunday's lesson, when was the last time you truly had to die to self for Christ's sake? That's part of love, because that's part of the process of love, to die to self. Because if we continue to live, then and in the same space where we're trying to be invited to the Holy Spirit, it's going to get crowded. The space is already partly full with us. We squeeze in a bit of Jesus, and we expect to reflect this love, which is impossible. I know for my own self, I may be a nice person, but I would struggle with those who would intentionally harm and hurt me. I would go to my knees. I would ask the Lord. I have to ask him to remove all that pride in me that does not want to let go of that offense, that I would, every time I see that individual or individuals, or if there was an incident where my heart was just torn up because pride rears its head, all of that I recognize as me. So if I am emptied, I've become a new creature. I'm supposed to be empty of Deborah. Deborah should have died. There should be a little headstone for Deborah somewhere else. And there should be the Holy Spirit living in me so that my response to the next offense will be as Christ's response, not my own. It is a dying to self. Because of the fact that Christ was willing to come to give up everything, sacrifice for us in order that we would be redeemed. Who do we love enough to allow Christ to let us die and let him move in? Because by the death of yourself and the infilling of the Holy Spirit in you, you are now fit to reflect that love that Christ has for someone else. The problem sometimes, many times, is that we are not willing to die to self. About 60% of us might die inside of us, but we retain some portion of humanity, of that sinful man. We have to be willing to allow that ourselves to die in a world that tells us that we must be all sorts of things. We must be self-confident. We must be self-aware. We must be this. We must be the everything that calls to feed the flesh and to feed pride is what we're taught. As Sister Gordon spoke about in training up the youth, it is also an emptying of them and a filling of the Holy Spirit in them that will lead to their eternal success. It is not taking the same child and just patching it up and developing it on the outside so they are just looking like good on the outside and rotting in the inside. So they become a physician. So they are a lawyer. Suppose they are a physicist or they do some great thing. But when Christ comes to the clouds and they are found to be without his spirit, without transformation, without the spirit of God, it's profited you nothing. So it is self-sacrifice that Christ is asking in light of the fact that he was willing to sacrifice for us, then in part our next thing is to sacrifice for others by allowing self to die. Can you speak of an incident where you have felt that struggle, perhaps, and that you have, or how you have allowed even parts of ourself to die? Most of us are still battling with emptying the inner man with Christ's help. But can anyone speak to maybe an experience or that struggle or that encouragement for someone else? Because we have all walked this way. And this would be an experience that we should all be having almost daily. How many of us have not been offended within the course of a week? What has your response been? How are you dying to self? Sheena?
You know, what's funny is that when you are in the workforce and you know, you're in meetings, you say something and then someone disrespects you. You know, what I find interesting is that everybody knows that you're a Christian, right? Everybody knows who the Christians are, but they look for us for our responses, which I find very interesting. And I've had many times I've been in meetings and people have said things that, oh, you're crazy, you're this, you're that, you know, that's not going to work. And they haven't said it in the nice way. And many times, which I never even thought that I did, a Christian friend, a manager that used to sit next to me, she said, Sheena, anytime you get angry, you start biting your upper lip. And we're all waiting for you to say something, but nothing comes, right? She says, so I just want to know, what are you thinking? And I said to her, listen, I have to fight self. I have to fight me, because once I say it, I can't take it back. And I've learned in my Christian walk, it is easier for me to bite my own lip than to come, because even we still have pride in us, to come back and say, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have behaved that way. So I find, and then I keep saying to myself, Sheena, if you say that, you can't go and knock on that door. Mm-hmm. How can you witness? How can you, after you left this office, you know, how can you go and knock on this door and say, here, I have something. I want to tell you about this friend that I have. And they were saying, well, where were your friend last week? So that's what keeps me with mm-hmm. my biting of my lip. And that's what keeps me when I say, Lord, take me out of this. Because I'm about to say something, and the old Sheena keeps telling me to come back, but I can't wrestle with that old Sheena, so I'm giving her to you. Yeah. And I just, you know, I just keep, and I didn't even realize I was biting my lip, you know. And they said, but, you know, I'm just thankful that God is still working within me, mm-hmm. And he keeps reminding me. And what I find interesting is that those people that I don't think are Christians, the funniest thing is that after the meeting, they always say this, and I have the conversation with Neville. I say, when I feel like giving this, they come up to me and say, don't you go to that Rockaway church. Aren't you a member of the Adventist? You know, and I say, Lord, thank you, thank you, thank you, that I didn't speak what I was entitled to speak, because that's what the world tells you. You're entitled to tell them that I allowed you to work within me.
Yeah, thank you so much, Sheena, for that. Because the truth is that it is a daily process in some way, shape, or form. Any relationship that you have with anybody at any time, be it just getting on a bus, going to a store, whether you're going to work, if it's in your home, which is even more significant, wherever you go, that you know that during the course of life that you show up. But we should not be showing up as ourselves. And so for that self-sacrifice, it was such a key phrase for me as I was tracking through the lesson, because in order to be like Christ, to honor what he has done for us in our own humanness, we can just go to him and say, Father, I acknowledge my great need of you. There is nothing in me that will allow me to be able to interact in this life in a way that is pleasing to you unless I am filled with your spirit. So I ask you to let me die and let me stay dead and let me continue to invite the Holy Spirit so that I can go about this witnessing trail by the way I live or speak or act in any way, shape, or form, that I would honor Christ and that I would be prepared for his soon coming. Henry?
Yeah, there is a text in the Bible that says, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And then there's another text that's sort of goes along with it, and it says that if someone does you wrong, then you are to go to them and to make amends, even if you're the innocent person. And especially if you're guilty of doing something wrong, you need to go to that person and work it out. And the Bible gives you a process which you follow in doing that. And you know, and for a time in the past, I struggled with that. I figured that I haven't done anything wrong to anybody. So why should I have to go to them? Well, they should be coming to me. You know, they know what they did. Why? How come they? That's how I'm thinking at that time. And over the years, you know, God has shown me by studying and adhering to His word. That you need to go. You need to make that move, because you can't come before me and ask me of forgiveness of your sins if you haven't forgiven the brother or sister of their sins against you. And so I struggled with that for years. And then I remember the weight that was lifted off my shoulder, and I was able to do that. And then there was another struggle. Because after I had done that, I thought the person would say, oh, I'm sorry, you know, I'm the one that did wrong. Or no. So there's another struggle, but Satan doesn't give up. You know, you get over one hurdle, Satan throws another one at you. And now I had another hurdle. I had to pray and ask God for strength to forgive them with all my heart and let it go. You have to learn to forgive and let it go. Jesus says when he takes your sins, and once he's taking your sin, he's forgiving you, he gets rid of it as if it had never happened. And that seems to be the most difficult thing for human beings. Well, it was difficult for me. And I just imagine other humans have that difficulty also.
It does.
And let it go.
To let it go. And all of that is indicative of the transformative power of Christ. And you see why we cannot stay alive as we ourselves stay alive in ourselves. If Henry doesn't die, then Henry holds on in pride to the offense and also the need to be vindicated. In the initial part of our lesson, it talked about the fact that Christ made himself as a bondservant. Christ came from glory to be a slave, a servant, a servant. We are not taught to be servants. in this life. We are taught to get as much as we can, be as much as we can be beautiful, be handsome, be talented, be educated, get power, get authority, be on top. So the message is directly contradictory to the message of Christ, which says, be a servant, be humble, forgive, forget, don't be offended, be kind, be patient, be compassionate. See yourself as Christ sees you. On your best day, your righteousness is as filthy rags. On your worst day, who are you? And yet, we struggle to let go of who we are and let Christ replace us. I know in my own life, I sometimes am talking to the struggle with the Lord. There's a constant conversation about my reaction, about what I think, about what I see or feel or so. It's a constant wrestling. I know in the end I'm asking the Lord, I've thrown myself to his feet to say, Father, take control. Every thought bind it up. Every desire in my heart, I recognize it as pride and as sin. I ask you to take control of me because Deborah is still alive in here, and I want her to die because I recognize that Deborah cannot be saved, but Christ in Deborah will allow me to be redeemed. So it is a struggle that we have. And as our sister says, sometimes you do have to bite your lip. It is better. Even Christ was silent when he came before the court. There's sometimes when silence is best because that internal struggle is going on. You see, the lesson just shows us the sacrifice that God gave, made when he came to redeem us requires so much more of each and every one. Before we can win souls, we must have our souls transformed, our minds transformed so that we can be fit vessels. Though Christ can use anybody and anything, but we do have to recognize that in everything there's change and transformation that is required. Yes. Now, I think Sister Isabella, and I think Brother Stewart, you were going after the hair. Go ahead.
I know that's too long. I think a little last week, my neighbor gave me a lot of trouble in the chomping the flu and they make a lot of noise. And I told the Lord, I leave you in your hand. For this week, thank you, Jesus. He very quiet, no chomping, and no chomping the flu, no going in my yard, you know, call my nail, talk a lot of, you know. And I told the Lord, I cannot take it no more. You can take this, you know.
Yes.
I'm tired.
And see, Sister Isabella, that is a struggle. That was a releasing that to God, acknowledging that
Yes. Sometimes
God doesn't fix things right away.
Yes.
But that part of that experience is that dying of self to say that we trust him. It's a step of faith. You do what you can do. And that you still retain, you go to Christ first.
Yes.
And to ask him to fit you to be able to deal with that situation.
Well, cuando ella see me, I got a stick, but I don't hear it. I never got a stick. Ella running. Are you beating me? You come and beat me. No. It's going.
Yeah.
And say, you coming no more in my job because she know me. And one day I beat her before me come in church. Yes, for good.
Okay.
I put the hair in the leg. On the third side and beat it for good. Call the police. Police take it for 2 weeks.
All right.
Yes. Well, that's the way y'all running to me.
Yeah. And see, you know, these experiences that we have, no matter what the experience, Christ still requires that we will reflect the love of Christ and the character of Christ in all that we experience.
Yes.
Thank you, Sister Isabella. Yes. Brother Stewart?
I was on the establishment the other day, right? And I had my money, right? And this lady was saying, you gotta put it up in your. I said, no. I said, lady, have a nice day, okay?
Hmm.
So I could have said some things, but I said, no, just have a nice day.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you, Brother Stewart. Sister Millicent.
You know, one of the outstanding things about Harriet Tubman was after she came out of slavery, after she escaped, she kept going back several times to rescue those who were still in slavery. And I guess this is just what God expects of us. If Jesus left heaven, or the place of purity, and came to earth, what is it so hard for us to go and rescue like people who were in the same condition, people who are in the same condition that we were in, go back to bring them out? That's all Jesus is asking. I have made the ultimate sacrifice for you. It's not such a great sacrifice because you were there. You know what it's like out there. You know the life of sin. Go out there and get your brothers and sisters out of that sin and bring them to where to understand my grace and mercy that I have extended to you.
Yes, that's true. And as we look, we go to Monday's lesson on the commitments call, the Matthew 4 and 18 and 20. It refers to the call of Peter and John as fishermen. And as you can imagine, that many of us have been called at different times of life after different circumstances. For these two men who were fishermen that were used to a certain type of life, these were adult men that were had committed themselves to a certain type of job, and they had known, the Bible says that they had were aware of Christ for over a year. But when Christ came, he asked them to follow him. He would make them fishers of men. So there is a call, but a call that also has with it the act of commitment. He would not have, he called them and they responded. And they responded to a commitment that they would make to learn, to follow, to be like the teacher that they had responded to. So it says here that in Monday's lesson that imagine if you were Peter and John. Your thoughts are on one thing, catching fish, a lot of them. The fishing has been good recently, and you're looking forward to another day of great fishing. Then in the early morning light, you see him approaching, Jesus of Nazareth. Little do you know that in a few moments, your whole life will change. You will never be the same again. And even in that last sentence, you will never be the same again. For every one of us who have been called and who have responded to that call, we should never be the same again. Wayne?
The call that God calls us, and you had asked about a question in Sunday's lesson. What was the last time you truly had to die to self for Christ's sake? It's for me, it would be the call to be in Bermuda. When I plan to only stay here for 3 years, and I keep getting the impression, and the last time the president and the secretary and the treasurer had to come to my office and said, listen, you know, you have to be here. And so it is a call for sacrifice for one to be away from family. But it's, as the lesson points out, it's an extraordinary call. It's a call to a higher purpose. Mm-hmm. And even though it may seem like a sacrifice, as the lesson pointed out earlier, the sacrifice, what you will gain in heaven, outweighs more than the sacrifice that you can make.
Yes. And that also is the end view, mm-hmm. that if we look at the end of the book and we see when Christ comes and that new Jerusalem, that new kingdom is set up, when there will be no more tears, no more pain, there will be a paradise, there will be newness. We will live into perfection. When Christ comes and he says to you, Sister Marie, well done, thy good and faithful servant, enter into the rest, you won't think of any sacrifice you have ever had to make. I had to speak to that person who is mean to me or mean to my family. I had to turn the other cheek for the salesperson who was rude to me. I had to forgive that person who was purposely making my life horrendous and painful. None of that is going to matter in the end when Christ comes. And so that just also emphasizes that not only are we in the present, but we must also live with a mind in the future for what we know is to be the end. One day we will give account, or one day we will stand before Him, and we want that outstretched arm. We don't want, depart from me. I never knew you. So you can depart with your big house, your expensive car, your expensive closet full of clothes, your degrees of any sort, your education. You can depart with all of that, or you can live your life allowing yourself to die, Christ to live in you and enter into His eternity and perfection. Brother Stewart?
There's a saying that says that God doesn't call the qualified. He qualifies those who He calls.
Yeah, He qualifies those that He called. And that exactly is it. As we look in the calls for Peter and John, as we look at the calls of Matthew, the tax collector, and that's another thing, as the lesson points out, that Christ called persons who it may not have appeared on the exterior were ready for the call. Mm-hmm. Matthew was still a tax collector. A thief. And Peter and John were just, but they had their own personality strengths and weaknesses, but on the exterior, there may have been no indication they were ready for that call. But Christ knew, and He is preparing us to go to those people who He is preparing internally for the call. So we have, if we have retained ourselves and we are going to Matthew, the tax collector, we will already judge and say, man is a crook. What do he want with Jesus? Oh, they have money, or they seem to be happy. We don't know anybody's heart, only Christ. And so if we allow the Spirit of God to transform us so that we have that same love, interest in soul winning, then Christ can work in us. And He can direct us to those people who He has already prepared, who are waiting for that call. Henry?
There was a time in my life that I didn't realize how serious that this call really is. And didn't realize the depth of this call. You know, I've seen people give their hearts to Christ as I was growing up. I said, and people say, you're Christians. Well, yeah, I go to church. And I thought that's all mattered. That all mattered. And I did my Sabbath school lesson, and I memorized the Bible texts, and memorized the books of the Bible. So I thought that was it. I didn't realize until I started really studying for myself what Christ was actually asking of me. He did that. And He did more. And He was asking us, and when he calls us away, and He called those guys away from their activities, their normal life, He was also calling them away from their families, from their loved ones, from their friends, from people who they were used to being around with and doing things with. He was calling us away from all of this. And sometimes we miss it because we want to, like you mentioned earlier, we want Christ in our life. But we want to hold on to some of those things that we like. We're not willing to give up. And Jesus said that if a man loves his mother or father or his brothers or sisters or his work more than me,
he's not worthy
of me. And this is serious. This is a serious walk with Christ. We are giving up stuff. Jesus says, come and do something. We should be willing to drop our jobs. Can we do that? Can you just drop that job that you're doing? You're making all this good money, and you're taking care of all your bills, and you can take a trip whenever you want, and you got stuff there. And God says, look, give that up. Because that's what He said to that rich man, and it's a parable, but it hits home to the reality of each of our lives, that we have to be willing to give up everything just like that, because Jesus gave up everything just like that.
Yes.
And now we must be willing to do the same for him.
For others. Thank you, Henry. Brother Wayne?
Many times individuals believe that Christ calls us to something big. But it doesn't necessarily, whatever he calls us to do, whatever your hand findeth to do, do it with all your might. And the next thing is that he empowers us, even though we may think that we are not able to do it, he equips us. He will give us what it is that we're lacking. When he called Moses, Moses found all the excuses in the world, but God had a solution for him. And we just have to be available to be used by him.
Yes, that's right. Arnold? Thank you, Wayne.
This is a very nice lesson. So what are we going to do? He's called us. So what are we going to do? 1 hour on the Sabbath and go out into the community? Huh? All of us, even me, have that issue of not going. Right? So, like the principal said, he equips us. But what God have your faith and go? What is hindering us from going? We got all this knowledge, all this wisdom, all the goodness, blessings that God has got given us. And God wants us to share that idea with them that's in darkness. For they can come forward. I like this text that she used this morning in Peter, where it says, we are chosen generation, we are royal priesthood. I'm sticking my chest up high. But then what does it say? Brought out of darkness to go forward and show forth his praises. Right? So he's called all of us to go and tell people. Right? Signs of the times, back when I was rolling on the streets, right? Didn't matter to me because I didn't know. But now God has pressed upon our hearts and our minds to go and do. It's not by works for any man boast, but it's by the gift of God. So we as a body of people must make up our minds and do what God requires us to do. If you don't do it when the sea is calm, don't try to get across the harbor when it's rough. When those brothers been across, it was calm when they started out, but it got rough. Then Jesus came and walked on the water. And they thought it was a ghost. And he said, peace be still. But he's given us that peace. He's given us that ability to go into the highways and byways, to do what he requires us to do. It's all outlined. Mm-hmm. Right? It's all outlined. We ain't got to make up no map and say about this and this and that. It's, he gave us the map. So help us to be obedient and do what God requires us to do.
Yes, thank you, Brother Arnold. And in fact, on Friday's lesson, we're going to go into that quotation there also from Sister White, that she does say, those who have spiritual oversight of the church should devise ways and means by which an opportunity may be given to every member of the church to act some part in God's work. Too often in the past, this has not been done. Plans have not clearly been laid and fully carried out whereby the talents of all might be employed in active service. There are but few who realize how much has been lost because of this. The leaders in God's cause, as wise generals, are to lay plans to advance moves all along the line. In their planning, they are to give special study to the work that can be done by the laity for their friends and neighbors. The work of God in this earth can never be finished until the men and women comprising our church membership rally to the work and unite their efforts with those of ministers and church officers. There is a longer quote there. I'm not going to read it all, but it does speak to us that the call, the commitment, the self-sacrificing, the chosen vessels that we are, is not for our own selves. It is for the benefit of those that are around us. And so that, as Sister White says, is the work that we should be actively engaged in. And thank you, Brother Arnold. I'm going to just continue. I know I have about, 15 minutes or so, right? Okay, so for commitment's call, Tuesday's lesson, Paul was God's chosen vessel. And we see a man who had started out in such a way that he was killing the saints of Christ, that he was responsible for making their lives grievous. But God saw in that vessel the person that he needed and was going to use to completely transform the world. And Paul did that by using the same zeal, the same finer points of character, by transforming those things and by using what God has probably given him naturally, certain talents, to be used to evangelize the rest of that early church. And so we look at the vessels that we are, that God can take what we have as we give it to him with all our fears, all our concerns about ourselves, all of the deficits that we should rightly be able to recognize in ourselves. For none of us are fit. None of us are ready. We cannot fight the hosts of hell. Only Christ can do that. But if we give ourselves to Christ, be willing to answer that call, to accept the commitment, we can be used by Christ in this work. The Wednesday's lesson speaks about the demands of love. Love is a word that's bantered around in so many things. We hear all the time, I love ice cream, I love Bermuda, I love you, I love this, I love my shoes, I love my car, I love, love, love. That's not love, what we're talking about. The love of Christ, the love that Christ had for each one of us in this world, that love is a love, as we said, that is so above what we as human beings are capable of showing. Because it's an active word. It is the love that says, because I love my brother, I will not do anything that's going to cause him to sin, or I am not going to in any way, shape, or form do any harm to him. If it means at a loss to myself, I will not do that thing, even though I might be entitled to do that thing. So love is a huge word, a huge action that the Holy Spirit will be able to equip us with, and we must turn to him. Even sometimes when we love God, as Peter did, he denied the Lord several times. So we fail sometimes, but God is merciful to continue wherever we are, wherever our path has led us, that God will continue in the work as we are willing. He asked Peter three times, do you love me? He didn't just say, yes, Lord, I love you. God said, feed my lambs. If you love me, you love my people. And if you love my people, you will do what is in their best interest. Sister Terry?
I think of that, what we say sometimes, love is what love does. You know, we can say that we love Christ, but it's always an evidence of what we do for him. You know, and that's why he probably asked Peter three times, you know, do you love me? Do you really love me more than all those other things? And so that's what I think, that's what Christ is asking us. If you love me, then do what I ask you to do. Feed my lambs. And three times he asked him, three times he answered, and three times he told him, well, if you do love me, then this is how it's going to be manifested. You'll go out and share the gospel with others.
Yes. And for Thursday's love's commitment, Jesus told Peter that when you give your heart to me and you follow me, it's going to be wonderful. You're going to have everything that you want. You'll never have a hard day's work. You will just coast through life. People will just bow down and say, boy, he's wonderful because he's a Christian. Just tell me all about Jesus, and it's going to be easy, easy every day. Every good thing Peter did, people will say, thank you, my goodness, I'm so happy. And you will just be skipping on daisies and just smiling every day will be wonderful. Is that what did Christ tell Peter that he would have to do? He was going to die. He was going to die stretched out. He was going to work hard. He was going to die internally or for self-sacrifice. And in the end, those same people that he wanted to share this message of redemption with were going to stretch him out. The same Christ who healed, the same people that Christ healed, were some of the same people at his trial that said, crucify him. and laughed at him on the cross. So as a believer, as a follower of God, the result of your responding to the call, of our response to the cause, is that we will be treated as Christ was treated. It is going to be a straight uphill trek. There is in 2 Corinthians, let me just make sure I have the right verse here. I wrote it down here. Because, dear, I wanted to read the verse. I don't remember where it came from. When Paul was describing all of the shipwrecks, the beating, the hunger, his experience of what the walk of Christ was like. So the word tells us that why would we be surprised at the hardships that we are going to experience? Your neighbors are not going to get along with you all the time. Your family is not going to get along with you all the time. People are going to talk about you. People are going to take your goodness and take it and not even look back. There will not be a thank you or a pat on the back or a kind word. They're going to hurt you and sneer at you. They're going to be empowered by Satan to discourage you. And we have to recognize that the commitment has to be a commitment steeped in the experience of Christ living in you, that you will not become discouraged. But don't be surprised. Don't be surprised at the hardness of the walk, because the Bible tells us that the end, as we said before, when Christ breaks through that sky and says, "Well done, Arnold. Well done, Donovan. Well done, Brother Eugene. Well done, Janet. Come." You will not remember any of those hardships, but expect them until the day you draw your last breath. Brother Elder Doug was standing here on Sabbath. Within a few short days, he is in a fight for his life. But he has the assurance of the God that he serves, because his life was right with his Savior. He's in faith, though the road will be hard, the road may be long, but his faith and his trust in the Savior, who said, just because you are walking this way, don't think that you will not experience hardship, pain, suffering. Things are going to go wrong. The very children that you raise, that you will spend on that education, are going to be the same children that are going to curse you. The same husband or wife you walk down that aisle with are going to be the very enemy within the walls of your house. The very job that you work 10, 15 hours and go in on weekends for, not the Sabbath, That same job, you'll be the first one to be let go, or you will not get your annual raises. There will not be faithfulness among the people that you counted as friends and as church members. But press on. Press toward the mark. And so this lesson, speaking very individually to our walk in Christ, this whole quarter's lesson, making friends for God, starts with us making friends with God first. Thank you, Lord.
That was a wonderful lesson. It's a wonderful lesson, and it's always on time. Thank the Lord for his goodness and his mercy towards us. He doesn't want us to perish. You know, he says, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. And that's what we have to do. There's a joy. We don't see it now, but what we have to sacrifice now is going to give us great rewards in the end. And so thank you, everyone, for participating. Did you all enjoy that? That was a wonderful lesson. It's certainly on time. And all we need to do is just to commit ourselves to the Lord, show Him through our love for Him that we're willing to do whatever it takes. Encourage one another, pray for one another, and most of all, let the Holy Spirit live in us so that He can work out His will and we will be doing the good pleasure that He has called us to. Our next quarter's lesson is entitled Education. And the highest education is that which comes from getting to know Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. So enjoy the Sabbath. Thank you, Sister Deborah, for that lesson. And encourage each one to study next week. And I'll see you again next Sabbath. Let's stand and have our closing prayer. Oh, and remember, I don't know if any of you remember your 13th Sabbath offering. Even though today is the 13th Sabbath, you can still, you know, whatever the Lord puts upon your heart. But just remember that it's something that the church has designed for the advancement of the mission work into all the world. Our church is about mission, and that's what we need to do, support it physically with our presence, our means, our prayers, whatever we can do for the Lord to advance His work, let's do it. Okay, let's stand. Father, we thank you so much for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you for what you have called us out of. And sometimes we don't fully understand it, Lord, but we thank you that your Holy Spirit is still striving with us, just like it strove with Peter. You know, Peter was not, Lord, what you wanted him to be, but you, because of who you are, you saw in him what he can be. And we thank you for his example. And I thank you for calling us individually because you see what we can be. You want us to be with you in glory. And not only us, Lord, but others. You want us to go out and to tell the world, to preach the gospel, to live the light. And we cannot do that by ourselves. So we need the Holy Spirit, Lord. So we're submitting ourselves to you once again, day by day, moment by moment. Lord, fill us. Give us the joy that only you can bring into our lives. And we will give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor. We're looking forward to that day when Jesus comes, Lord. But again, not only us did Jesus come to die. There are many people out there who are waiting, just like the tax collector, Matthew. He was up in that tree, and the moment he heard your voice, he responded. You say, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto myself. So that's what we need to do. We need to lift up Jesus, not only in our words, but the way that we live. And again, we cannot do any of that by ourselves. We need the Holy Spirit. We need the Spirit. And just on the day of Pentecost, you liberally gave it. You're willing to do it for us as well. Fill us, Lord. Fill us with your Spirit so that we can enjoy life abundantly and we can invite others to enjoy that as well. And then when we can look up in that day and say, lo, this is our God. As always, Lord, you keep your promises all the time. You keep them. This time of waiting, you know, sometimes we might get tired. But you always come through and let us hold on to your hand. Let us remain faithful because you are faithful. And what you call us to, you will enable us to do. You will enable us by the Spirit to live a life that's pleasing to thee. And so I wait upon that for myself, and I wait upon that, and I pray for that for my brothers and my sisters. And most of all, Lord, it'll make you glad if we all allow the Spirit to live in us. So we thank you and we praise you. Bless us, Father, so that we can be a blessing to you as we serve others. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.